Good afternoon and welcome to today's meeting of the Commonwealth Club of California. You can find us on the internet at commonwealth.org. I'm John Bolin, President of KQED, member of the Commonwealth Club's Board of Governors, and your moderator for today's program. And now it is my pleasure to introduce today's distinguished speaker, Tavis Smiley, noted television and radio broadcaster and author of the new book, Fail Up, 20 Lessons on Building Success from Failure. I had the pleasure of working with Tavis when I was served as Chief Content Officer of PBS at PBS headquarters in Washington, D.C. for 4 years before returning to KQED here in the Bay Area last year. He's the host of the television talk show Tavis Smiley on PBS 5 days a week and the host of the Tavis Smiley Show from Public Radio International, plus a public radio program called Smiley and West with Dr. Cornell West. Fail Up is Tavis's 15th book. His memoir, What I Know for Sure, My Story of Growing Up in America, became a New York Times bestseller, and the book he edited, Covenant with Black America, became the first nonfiction book by a Black-owned publisher ever to reach number one on the New York Times bestseller list. And if that's not enough to keep one man busy 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, he established the nonprofit Tavis Smiley Foundation to provide leadership training and development for youth. As a colleague, Tavis is an incredibly creative person with the drive and the enthusiasm to follow through and actually make his ideas a reality. Back in 2007, as the lead up to the historic 2008 presidential election was just getting underway, Tavis called me at PBS, as he often did with ideas. And this time he said, well, how about if we stage the very first presidential debate of the election season for all the contenders from both the Democratic and the Republican Party for those nominations? And what if the moderator and all the journalists on the panel were people of color? It was an idea that was both daunting and expensive, but brilliant. And a few months later, I was actually kind of surprised to find myself sitting in the auditorium at Howard University with 7 presidential candidates up on the stage as Tavis and PBS made history with the All-American Presidential Forums. But like all of you, I'm also a viewer, listener, and fan of Tavis Smiley. As a leader of a public media organization, I actually have the television on in my office all day, but I have the sound off so I can get some work done. And of course, the television is always tuned to KQED public television. But every so often at 2 p.m. when we repeat Tavis's show from the previous evening, I simply can't resist the temptation to turn the sound up and listen. And as I did recently when Tavis interviewed Wynton Marsalis. On a par with his other talents, in my opinion, is Tavis's skill as a conversationalist and an interviewer. He is quite simply one of the best in the business. We are very proud to have him on public radio and TV, and we're delighted to hear from him in person today at the Commonwealth Club. Please welcome Tavis Smiley.
Good afternoon. Try that again. Good afternoon. All right. Now I feel welcome. That's much better, much better. It is an honor, a blessing, in fact, to be back here at the Commonwealth Club of California. It's been a few years since I was last here. I was trying to think what the book was when I was last year. I can't even recall it, but I'm so delighted to have been invited back to speak to such an august gathering of persons in the Bay Area who value Socratic exchange and good dialogue, and so I look forward to the question and answer period much more than I look to look forward to my remarks. I think that part of what's wrong with America is that we are too titillated by, too engaged with monologue and not often enough serious about dialogue. And so it is always the dialogue portion of the conversation that turns me on more than the monologue. So let me hasten to make a few remarks and save room for our moderator, Mr. Drummond, to lead us in a conversation about whatever is on your mind today here in San Francisco. But thank you again for the honor that I have today to say a few words with you at this moment in this critical moment in America's history. Before I get into my remarks, let me just say quickly how much I appreciate John Bolin taking the time today to come here to introduce me with such kind words. I was thinking, John, as I was listening to your introduction, that may very well be, sir, the second nicest introduction I've ever received. And I only say second nicest because I was in Chicago the other day, and the person to introduce me did not show up, and I did it myself. Other than that, it's an awfully nice introduction. John mentioned that we did have a chance to work together when he was at PBS, and I look back on this 20-year journey. This book, Fail Up, is being released. It has been released, I should say now, this year, 2011, on the occasion of my 20 years in the broadcast business. And the lessons I've learned along the way, primarily by making missteps and miscalculations and miscues. Anyone who is successful in any field of human endeavor will tell you, if they're being honest, and that's the key phrase, if they're being honest, they've learned much more from their failures than they ever learned from their successes. We'll talk about that, I suspect, in just a second. But one of the moments in my 20-year career thus far that I regard significantly, and I'm glad that John referenced it, was the opportunity that PBS gave me under John's leadership to conduct these all-American presidential forums. I think it's important in the most multicultural, multiracial, and multi-ethnic America ever. And if the Bay Area is nothing else, it is a microcosm of the world. Multicultural, multiracial, multi-ethnic. Our institutions and all individuals who run those institutions have to be held accountable to advancing an agenda that is in the best interest of all Americans, not just the rich and the lucky, but those who are disenfranchised politically, economically, socially, and culturally. And so it was my honor to be supported by PBS under John's leadership to conduct these two debates. One at Howard with all of the Democratic candidates for office, and one at Morgan State for all the Republican candidates for office. And so, John, thank you again for your service at PBS, and what an honor it is, and how blessed you are in the Bay Area to have John Bolin back here in your neck of the woods running what is a great station. I was just there this morning on the air. You got some great programming there, great talent there, and new leadership now with John back. So, John, thank you for coming today for such a kind introduction. Let me just hasten to share a few thoughts, I want to get to whatever is on your mind today. It is difficult to disconnect, in my mind at least, in the few minutes that I have here, difficult to disconnect this book, Fail Up, from the fear that I sense that is palpable in America right now about our fear of failing. That fear of failing is palpable for me, as I said, as I move around the country. I feel it, I sense it, I can smell it, almost taste it, John, everywhere I go. There was a report called the Rasmussen Report that came out some months ago that found that just over half of all Americans think that our best days as a nation are behind us. That's serious. When half your country, just over half of your citizenry, thinks that the best days of the country are already behind it, makes it difficult to understand how we're going to navigate forward with that kind of dark psychic cloud, as it were, hanging over the country. As my friend Cornel West might put it, America has the blues. America has the blues, and we got to figure out how we wrestle our way forward, navigate our way forward with a country that has been inflicted with the blues. So half the country thinks our best days as a nation are behind us. I ask you how it is that we move forward when parents think, when grandparents think, that their kids and their grandkids are not going to do better than they have done. That's where we are now. And that's what's making Americans, I think, in many ways, frozen by this fear of failing, that we don't think, for the first time in this nation's history, many of us do not believe that our children, that our grandchildren are going to do as well as we have done. And if America is about anything, it's about every generation doing better than the previous. And now we've arrived at this place where people are really scared about this. I'm not going to ask for a show of hands, but if there are parents or grandparents in the room, I know that if I ask you in the tradition of the black church, you'd say amen to that. Because I know that you feel that. There are too many parents who now have students, have children who are graduating college who can't find a job. Many parents have kids now who are living, I'm not going to ask for a show of hands, but I know some of you have your kids living back at home with you, and that was not the plan. I know too many grandparents now for all kinds of reasons, certainly in my community because of the drug epidemic, too many grandparents who are now raising their grandkids. That was not part of the plan. I see all across the country the evidence abounds that we are afraid of the future. We are afraid of failing on a personal level, on a professional level. Too many folk downsized. I love these fancy words for being fired, but downsized and companies trying to right size and greedy companies making more money at home and sending more jobs abroad, and Wall Street is back in the money, and all the rest of us are still struggling trying to make it through a recession that they tell us no longer even exists, if you can believe that. There are all kinds of reasons. I mean, the war on terrorism has many of us frozen by fear. Even with bin Laden dead, we still know that while the world may be rid of, there may be absent from the world one more thug, one more rogue, we don't necessarily feel any safer at this point just because bin Laden is dead 10 years later when he wasn't running nothing anyway, after $1 trillion spent and thousands of lives lost, ours and theirs. Do we really feel safer as we take to the streets and celebrate waving flags about the death, capture and death of bin Laden? The evidence abounds that we are a country right now that is gripped by fear, primarily the fear of failing. Add to that my read of history, William. My read of history suggests to me, I'm not a historian, but my read of history suggests there is not one empire, not one, in the history of the world that at some point did not falter or fail. Maybe you're reading something that I'm not reading, but my read of history says that every empire in the history of the world has at some point faltered or failed. Every empire eventually trips over itself. Now, I don't know what it is about us in America that makes us I don't know what it is about us in America that won't even allow us to wrestle with that notion. Is it our arrogance? Is it our ignorance? Is it our hubris? Is it our patriotism that's now morphed into nationalism? What is it about us that doesn't even allow us to consider that this experiment we call America may one day implode? And I would submit to you with humility that if, in fact, that is going to happen for us, if we're on the verge of that, it will happen primarily because of the weight of poverty crushing this country. At some point, we are going to have to get serious about those who are disenfranchised, as I intimated earlier, politically, economically, and culturally, socially. That weight of poverty is going to crush this country at some point. You cannot advance a civilized nation too far into the future when 1% of the people control 90% of the wealth. Pardon my English, that math just don't add up. That dog just won't hunt. At some point, we're going to have to wrestle with what it means to be a nation where the gap between the have-gots and the have-nots continues to widen. We are going to get crushed under the weight of our own poverty. Raises a fundamental question then here in San Francisco and beyond of whether or not we are going to side with the weak, or are we going to side with the strong? Are we going to side with those who are through no fault of their own catching hell and trying to make it? Or are we going to side with the rich and the lucky? We got a fundamental question here about who we're going to side with, the weak or the strong. I found in my own life, in this 20-year career, I'm weaving this book and my thoughts about the nation together at this critical juncture. I find in my own life that professionally, and maybe even personally, but certainly professionally, since we're here at the Commonwealth Club, a room full of leadership professionals, I found in my own life that life is really ultimately about a struggle between two things. When you really boil it down, when you really deconstruct it, life is really about two things. Every one of us as professionals, every one of us as leaders, finds ourselves, that is, in a daily struggle of truth versus power. Truth versus power. Think about it. Marinate on that for a second. That's what we're up against. Truth versus power in our own lives. Put another way, are you going to be a truth teller, or are you going to be a power grabber? A truth teller or a power grabber? That's what life is ultimately about. It's a struggle every day between truth and power. And too often we allow ourselves to choose power and the truth gets trumped, at least in the short run. Because no lies, Dr. King said, can live forever. Truth crushed to the earth will rise again. But in the short run, we have to make this choice between truth and power. Somebody has got to commit himself, herself, themselves to telling the truth. I believe, in fact, it is the telling of the truth that allows the suffering to speak. It's the telling of truth that allows suffering to speak. We can't allow the suffering of everyday people in this country to end up rendered invisible because nobody wants to give voice to it. Socrates put it this way, the unexamined life is not worth living. The unexamined life is not worth living. What kind of lives are we living? What kind of legacies are we leaving? I have a very simple definition of leadership, and it goes like this. You can't lead people unless you love people. And you can't save people unless you serve people. You can't lead if you don't love. You can't save if you don't serve. So I don't care what your leadership position is. In any field of human endeavor, when we wrestle with leadership and what it really means, again, in any field of human endeavor, it comes down to that formulation. You can't lead folk unless you love them. You can't save folk unless you serve them. So the only thing that matters about leadership is really this. What is the depth of your love for everyday people? And what is the quality of your service to them? That's what leadership is. I don't care what business you're in. Do you love people? And are you willing to serve people? Loving people and serving people is what leadership is all about. And in that process, somebody has to have the courage, the conviction, the commitment, and the character to be willing to tell the truth. Now, to be sure, there is a price for that. There is a price for telling the truth, and there's a price for connecting your heart to the hearts of the least among us. As a matter of fact, the closer you are to everyday people, the more likely it is you'll end up being crucified for taking that position. So there's a direct link. There's an old song we sang in my church, little Pentecostal church I grew up in, little black church in Indiana. We sang a song years ago that said, must Jesus bear the cross alone and all the world go free? No, there's a cross for everyone and there's a cross for me. Now, if you happen to be agnostic or atheist, I ain't mad at you. God bless you. Even if you happen to be agnostic or atheist, you understand the point I'm making here. Every one of us has our own cross in life that we have to bear. Put another way, there is no success without failure. Those two things are inextricably linked. Anyone who's being honest, again, in any field of endeavor will tell you they've learned more from their failures, as I said earlier, than they've learned from their successes, which is why I so love that Beckett quote that you'll find on the first page of this new book, Fail Up. Beckett put it this way, ever tried? Ever failed? No matter. Try again. Fail again. Fail better. I love that. Try again. Fail again. Fail better. Try again. Fail again. Fail better. I realized looking back on these 20 years, John, that all I've really done is failed my way up. That's all that I've done. When I look back on this 20-year journey, it's been a series of failing up. As I said earlier, there is no success without failure. Babe Ruth put it this way, every strike gets me closer to the next home run. I think we have to start to see, not be frozen by failure, as so many Americans are. We have to learn to see failure as a friend. Failure is not fatal. Failure is not final. Failure doesn't have to have the last word. We only fail our way up to the extent that we are willing as individuals, as families, as companies, as corporations, as a country. We only fail our way up to the extent that we are willing to learn the lessons from the failure of others and from the failures that we make ourselves. When we learn those lessons, we qualify ourselves to fail our way up. I look back on my career in the writing of this book, I realize a couple of things. One, that I had more failures than I even knew. Looking back on it, number one. But I also realized, secondly, that I wasn't the only one. That everybody I know who is successful at anything also failed their way up. I said the other day that Barack Obama is the poster child for failing your way up. For those who know his backstory, you recall when he first ran for Congress against a guy named Bobby Rush out of the south side of Chicago, Bobby Rush beat the brakes off of him 3-1. He got smoked by Bobby Rush when he first ran for Congress. In 2000, he doesn't even have the credentials to get into the Democratic convention down in L.A. where I live. He was outside the convention hustling up some credentials, trying to get in the building. Couldn't even get in the building in 2000. And in 2008, he's sitting in the Oval Office as President of the United States. If that ain't failing your way up, I don't know what is. It's true of presidents, it's true of talk show hosts, it's true of anybody else in this country. If you're going to succeed, whatever that means, you're going to do it with a litany of failures in your rearview mirror. Nothing wrong with that. The question is, what are we prepared to do to learn from those failings individually, vis-a-vis our families, and vis-a-vis the family of this nation called the United States of America? Now, here's where I think I want to make a turn. I've discovered in America something fundamental and universal about all of us. And it's hard these days, given how fragmented America is in so many ways, politically, socially, economically, and culturally. We're so fragmented. We're so divided in so many ways. And yet there's one thing I think that we all agree on. I don't care if we're black, white, red, brown, or yellow, rich or poor, urban or suburban, educated or illiterate, gay or straight, Republican or Democrat, those divisions, those uniquenesses notwithstanding, the one thing I think we all have in common is simply this. Every one of us wants to live in a nation that is as good as its promise. Every one of us wants to live in a nation as good as its promise. Nobody's asking for more. Nobody ought to settle for less. But we want to live in a nation that will one day be as good as its promise. And if you think we are there yet, let me disabuse you of that notion right quick. We are not yet a nation as good as its promise. There is still a huge divide, a huge gap between the promise of America and the possibility in America for all of her citizens. That gap is real. And that gap between the have-gots and the have-nots continues to widen. That gap between the promise of America and the actual possibility in America for everyday people, that gap is far too wide. Into that gap, into that breach, somebody must stand. If this country is going to be a nation as good as its promise in these difficult and challenging days, somebody has to stand in that gap, prepared to speak truth to power. So again, that suffering can be heard. That suffering won't be rendered invisible. I wonder, in 2011, who that's going to be. Some of us think that just because we elected Barack Obama, that he would solve all of these issues. In the book, Fail Up, I talk about these 20 mistakes I've made, these 20 failings that I've had, and sometimes failings and mistakes can be the perception of others. Inside of Black America, I know all too well, just a few years ago, what it felt like to be beloved and regarded and respected by your own community, and then overnight in Black America, you become persona non grata. Every black person in this room knows what I'm talking about. All of Black America turned on me, it seemed, just a couple of years ago because they thought I was being too hard on the president. Tavis is a hater. Tavis is a traitor. Tavis is a sellout. Tavis is an Uncle Tom. I got called everything but a child of God just a couple of years ago, all because I was talking about holding then-Senator Obama accountable. It is fascinating to me, 3 years later, how everything I was saying then essentially makes up the progressive critique of the president now, today, 3 years later, that I was saying just a few years ago. But inside of Black America, Black folk were so hell-bent, so intent, so committed to making sure that Barack Obama was elected by any means necessary that you couldn't even in Black America have a critical conversation about the president without being called a hater. And all I was doing then was the same thing I had always done, which is to hold all leaders accountable to the best interest of everyday people, particularly and especially those who are catching the most hell. It's hard for black folk to remember how much we loved Bill Clinton because now we love Barack Obama so much. But before Obama, we were in love. We had a love affair with a guy named William Jefferson Clinton. And when Bill Clinton was president, I beat him down when he sat on his hands and did not go into Rwanda. That ethnic cleansing was going on. Clinton didn't do nothing. He and Madeleine Albright personal friends of mine, but they sat on their hands and didn't do anything. I jumped on them publicly about that. When he sandbagged Lonnie Grenier after appointing her, nominating her for the Justice Department position, he pulled the rug from underneath Lonnie Grenier, even though she was their friend, had been in Bill and Hillary's wedding, snatched the rug from underneath her, didn't let her even make her case. I took him to task for that. When he signed that racist crime bill, which made legal that 100-to-1 crack to powder cocaine discrepancy, you got to get caught with 100 times more powder than crack just to get the same sentence. It's racist because powder is used in the suites, crack is used in the streets. It was a racist policy. I jumped on him about that. When he signed that welfare bill, jumped on Bill Clinton about that. Not a single Negro nowhere in America ever wrote me a letter, sent me an email, wrote a blog saying, Tavis, you can't talk about the president that way. You can't critique the president. Shut up. Don't talk about holding him accountable. Bill Clinton's our boy. Nobody said that. But the minute this black man named Obama shows up, all of a sudden I'm supposed to shut up, not say anything about holding him accountable. And the mantra in black America became, let the brother get in first. He got to get in first. And now you know what them same Negroes are saying? Wait till the second term. He going to get us in the second term. We know unemployment is triple, quadruple the national average in black America. We know we are not better off today than we were 2 years ago. We know at the moment what we're really celebrating is more symbolism than substance at the moment. But let their brother get to that second term. He got us in the second term. See, that's not standing in your truth. If I hadn't talked about accountability, if I hadn't done for Obama what I'd done for everybody else, I couldn't stand here today with any kind of integrity when it comes to talking about holding people accountable. In this book, I share all kinds of lessons I've learned along the way about what you do when people turn against you. That's the chapter about Obama. In this book, I talk about humility. And how I learned the hard way that before honor comes humility. We have to learn how to be humble. We have to learn how to revel in the humanity of other people. I learned that lesson the hard way about what it means to be humble and how honor, how humility must always come again before any honor. There are certain lessons in this book that I was so embarrassed by, certain failings, certain mistakes I've made that I was so embarrassed by, I hadn't even told my parents after all these years. Before the book arrived at my parents' home, I had to call them and warn them so they would not go into full cardiac arrest that some of the things they were about to read about their firstborn child, they didn't even know. My parents didn't know that earlier in my life I got arrested and went to jail for check kiting. I didn't know what check kiting was, but I apparently was engaged in it. When you go to so many young people today, I'm serious today about financial literacy as I've always been. I've been traveling the country for years conducting free seminars to the public about financial literacy. Why? Because I got burned because I went to jail when I was in college and got put on probation, almost got kicked out of school. And keep in mind, I'm the first person in either side of my family to go to college. So I couldn't dare tell my parents I got arrested, went to jail for writing bad checks. But these colleges throw, the minute you hit campus, they're throwing credit cards at you and checking accounts and every bit of financial trickery they can throw at you. I didn't know nothing about money. I'm from 13 kids, 13 people in one family, living in a one-bathroom, three-bedroom trailer with 13 people. I knew nothing about money. Walk around with holes in my shoes with cardboard stuffed in them, and I get to campus, you give me credit cards and checking accounts and all this other stuff. I got caught up in it. And I wasn't doing anything malicious with it. I wasn't running some scheme. I just didn't know how to balance a checkbook. And I got caught in a check-kiting sting, writing checks for $7.14 for pizza. That's what I got burned for, a $7.14 check for pizza. And they happened to be rounding up check-kiters, and here I am with a couple of checks that aren't covered for $17.14, and I end up going to jail. I end up getting a record. My parents didn't even know about that, but I learned a lesson early on about the value of money, and I try to impart that in this book for all of us. Too many of us spend money we don't have to buy stuff we don't need, trying to impress folk we don't even like. Think about that. But I learned the value of money. I worked for the mayor of Bloomington when I was a college student, had a great opportunity, had a work-study job. I mean, what college kid gets to work for the mayor of the city, Mary Allison in Bloomington, Indiana? And I did what too many Americans are still doing today. I was padding my time card. I work 3 hours and write down four, and I'm only making $4.50 an hour. The first person to go to college, I'm writing checks for pizza so I can have something to eat because I can't afford to live in the dorm or eat the dorm food. So I'm trying to write a check and go cover it right quick. And so I'm trying to eat. I'm trying to make some money to pay my tuition. I'm the first person to go. My parents have no money to send me to college. I'm trying to get through. So I work 3 hours, write down four. Work 4 hours, write down five. I got caught. The mayor of the city called me in and said to me, as only a woman could, who was the same age roughly as my mother, just looked me in the eye when everybody else in the office was telling her, we're about to call the cops and arrest this Negro. He's going to jail. He's been stealing money, padding his time card. The mayor said, put the phone down. Tavis, come see me. And she sat me in front of her desk, and I'm crying like a baby already. And she looks me dead in the eye and says, very simply, you let me down. Ooh. You disappointed me. She said to me something, John, I've never forgotten, and I've lived by it every day. She said, you didn't just steal, Tavis, but you stole the people's money. You stole the taxpayers' money. She said, let this be a lesson to you about the value of the public trust. And the reason all these years later I take my work so seriously on public TV and public radio is because I value that public trust. I know what it means for the public to believe in your integrity. And that's why even folk don't understand or agree with what I'm trying to say, I've got to be committed to my own personal integrity. I've got to be a truth teller. I've got to side with truth, not grabbing for power. But I learned that lesson about the public trust and integrity from the mayor in Bloomington, Indiana. There's so many stories in the book, personal stories, professional stories. I'm out of time. But I lay out in this book on the occasion of this 20th anniversary these 20 worst mistakes and failings that I've had, hoping that we can empower somebody else, that we can inspire somebody else. In the book, when you read it, you'll find yourself in the narrative. Your story is not mine. My story is not yours. Your journey isn't mine. Mine's not yours. But every one of us, one thing we can all agree on, you ain't going to get out of here without having some failings. So this is a universal theme, number one. But in these stories, you'll find yourself, you'll situate yourself, you'll learn some things about what the country is up against and how I think we individually and collectively can learn in this moment, now more than ever, that we are going to have to fail our way up as a nation, as people. We are going to have to fail our way up out of the malaise, out of the mess that we are in. I believe it's possible. I close on this note. It's possible, I believe, not because I'm optimistic, but because I'm hopeful. I am not a person by definition, by nature, who is optimistic. I'll tell you why right quick. Optimism suggests that there is a particular set of facts or circumstances, conditions, in other words, something you can see, feel, or touch that gives you reason to believe that things are going to get better. Most often in my life, I've not had any of that evidence that I could see, feel, or touch that gave me reason to believe that I should be or could, in fact, be optimistic. But on the other hand, I am a perfect witness that you can build a whole life on hope. You can build an entire life on hope. As Americans, we can never, ever lose sight of hope. So even when the evidence isn't there to suggest to us that things are going to be all right, we are a hopeful people. We are a hopeful nation, and we can never, ever lose sight of that. And so it is my hope, my sincere hope, that what this book will do more than anything else, or as much as anything else, is get folk to understand that Beckett was right, that we got to keep trying again, failing again, and failing better. Thank you very much for listening. I appreciate it.
Good. Are you going to, okay, you stand out there. Good. Got it.
Our thanks to Tavis Smiley, noted television and radio broadcaster and author of the new book, Fail Up, 20 Lessons on Building Success from Failure. I'm William Drummond, professor at the Graduate School of Journalism at the University of California at Berkeley, and your moderator for today's audience question period. And I have had the pleasure of reading this book, and I have to say that Mr. Smiley is one of the last optimists left in America. It's 20 chapters. Each one of them is a page-turner. And I think my only question is about the title of the book, Fail Up. I think it ought to be entitled My Wicked, Wicked Ways. It is candid to a fault. And each chapter, you wonder, this man has destroyed his life, but he takes a lesson from that, He bounces back. He copes. He comes out stronger. And for someone like me that's in the business of motivating young people, this is, all of these are just gold. Everybody should get this book. Go out there and get that book and read it. Now we've got some questions, so let's begin. Your new book focuses on building success from failure. What mistakes continue to bother you? Which failures have been the hardest to bounce back from?
Wow, that's a powerful question.
I think the things that we're all challenged by the most, if we're being honest, and sometimes it's hard to admit this, of the 15 books I've written, this has been the most difficult because it requires you to be really, really, really transparent, really, really, really authentic. Sometimes that can be therapeutic, and sometimes professional drama, it can be rather painful. But I think, generally speaking, the things that challenge me the most are the things that that I know would let my parents down. As a black man especially, the one thing I never want to do is disappoint my mama. And when there are things that you know are beneath your character, I think speaking for all of us now, if I might be so bold, those are the things that trouble us the most. When we have lapses in our own personal character, when we have character failings, that is to say a lack of humility or lying or cheating or cowardice when we should have been courageous. Those kinds of character flaws are the ones, I think, that disappoint us the most. And every day, every single day, as I suggested earlier, I find myself sometimes in big ways, sometimes in small ways. Sometimes there's a lot of money on the line. Sometimes there's no money on the line. Sometimes people are looking, and sometimes I'm in a room by myself. But I have to make decisions about whether or not I'm going to be a truth teller or a power grabber. And every day I find myself having to come back to my own character to make those assessments. But I think the things that challenge us most, the things that still cause me the most difficulty on a regular basis, is trying to always make the right decision, always trying to side with truth, because these temptations are real, it can be a challenge.
You stated that you think the 2012 presidential race will be one of the most racist in American history. Why is that? Can you elaborate on the 2012 election?
I got in a whole bunch of trouble for making that comment just a couple days ago on this book tour, as a matter of fact. It's funny to me. I guess when you have distinguished yourself, whatever that means, in the way that I have, by having opinions and being a commentator, even when you're on book tour talking about a book fail up, they want to ask you about everything else in the world, about Bin Laden, about the campaign. They got Tavis Smiley in the studio. We're going to ask him all these questions, and maybe we'll get to the book. I'm trying to sell a book. Can we please talk about fail up? But I got to ask a question, excuse me, on NBC the other day. I'm being funny. I'm always happy to do that because I want to add my voice wherever I think it makes sense. But I got to ask on NBC the other day on the book tour in New York about this race. This was specifically the week that Donald Trump just lost his mind. About this whole birth certificate nonsense. And I was asked on NBC about the campaign. What I said was that the evidence is growing, that this is going to be not just the most expensive, but the most divisive, the ugliest, the nastiest, and the most racist campaign for the White House in history. The evidence every day continues to grow that is how ugly, that this race is going to be. It's amazing to me how you can say the ugliest, the nastiest, the most divisive, the most expensive, and the only thing people jump on is that R word. Tavis Smiley says it's gonna be the most racist. And all of a sudden, you know, I'm playing the race card. And for three nights on the Fox News channel, Riley and Hannity are beating me like a punching bag, and then Limbaugh gets into it on radio the next day, and before I know it, the whole conservative citadel on TV and radio has come after me for making a comment. And their argument, of course, is that Tavis has now, you know, stacked the deck. It's like, it's funny, I'm playing the race card at the same time stacking the deck. It's like their argument essentially was that what Tavis has done is tried to shift this conversation such that any person on the right, any Republican who challenges this president will automatically on demand be playing the race card just because they're raising legitimate questions by his birth certificate or anything else. We're not racist. We're not playing the race card just because we raise these questions. Of course, that wasn't my point at all. I'm all for a vigorous debate. The part that was funny for me, Professor Drummond, is that one day, you know, I'm a hater of the president. I'm persona non grata. I'm hating on Barack Obama. And then the next day, I'm accused of being the head of his reelection campaign committee. You know, I'm on TV giving the Obama talking points. I'm the last Negro who you will ever see on TV giving the Obama administration talking points. My friend and my radio partner, Cornel West, puts it this way, and I'll be quiet on this question. I could talk for hours about this. Dr. West puts it this way. I know it sounds Jacksonian, as in Jesse Jackson, because of Jesse, everything is a rhyme. You know, Jesse, up with hope and down with dope. Y'all know Jesse, put hope in your brains, not dope in your veins. From the outhouse to the White House. With Jesse, everything is a rhyme. Content without context is pretext. You know, Jesse rhymes everything. So I know it sounds Jacksonian, but it's really Westian. Dr. West said on our radio program some days ago, with regard to this president, Professor Drummond, we have to respect him, we have to protect him, and we have to correct him. And I think Professor West, as wise as he is, was right about that. We always respect the president, Republican or Democrat, black or white. We respect the president. We have to protect the president. The week of the birth or nonsense, the president needed to be protected. I was happy to do that. But there are times, as you well know, listening to my work, he needs to be corrected. You need to be corrected about these wars. Dr. King was right. War is the enemy of the poor. He needs to be corrected about this budget. I believe that budgets are moral documents. Budgets are moral documents. You can say what you say, but you are what you are. And we know what you are when you put your budget on the table. What this budget that they're talking about now says about America is immoral. Budgets are moral documents. You got to correct the president on that. When black unemployment is out of control, and you're afraid to talk about it, much less do anything about it, because you're afraid of being accused of being tribal, you weren't afraid when Wall Street called you for help, of being pro-Wall Street. You weren't afraid of being pro-auto industry. You weren't afraid of being pro-Jew, pro-State of Israel. You weren't afraid of being pro-gay and pro-lesbian. And all those are legitimate issues. Don't get me wrong. I support him on the issues. But why is it that black people, the folk who supported you the most, the ones who are hurting the most, get left, you know, swimming for themselves because you're afraid of being tribal? And what we end up celebrating in black America is symbolism and not substance, and we sitting around waiting for the second term. That's nonsense to me. Respecting, protecting, and when necessary, correcting.
Now that you mentioned Professor West, what do you think of his rap album?
I love it. I think Dr. West is, I regard him not just because he's my radio partner, but I've known him for 25 years. He's the big brother that I never had. I'm the eldest of 10 kids, but he's my dear and abiding friend and big brother. Dr. West is, to my mind, the nation's leading public intellectual. He has a heart full of grace and a soul generated by love. But what I love most about him, beyond that, Professor Drummond, is that there are a lot of smart people in the academy, a whole lot of smart people in the academy, a lot of smart folk in the ivory tower, although I am mindful of Calvin Coolidge's formulation that the world is full of educated derelicts. But there are a lot of smart people in the academy, a lot of smart people in the ivory tower. Cornel West has what I call a usable intellect. He takes that intellect and he makes it usable, applicable for everyday people. He does that in the classroom. He does it on Real Time with Bill Maher. He does it on Smiley and West on public radio. He does it on CDs, spoken word and rap CDs with other artists when they ask him to come on. He uses every gift that God has blessed him with to try to enlighten, to try to encourage, to try to inspire, to try to empower people, and I celebrate that about him.
You're listening to the Commonwealth Club of California radio program, and our guest today is noted television and radio broadcaster Tavis Smiley, who's discussing his life and career and the lessons for success that come from failure. Now, I'm going to exercise the right of the chair and ask you a question that has not come from the audience, mm-hmm. But you and I have a mutual friend. We had a mutual friend, Cheryl Flowers. You mentioned her. And Cheryl passed away from breast cancer, mm-hmm. And I have a personal interest in that because my wife, Faith Fancher, also passed away 7 years ago of breast cancer. Now, that also, dealing with someone who is fatally ill, is a learning experience. Mm. Can you share with us insights that you might have gotten from that experience with Cheryl?
I better do it real fast because you're going to make me cry. Cheryl was from the Bay Area, and she was and still is the only executive producer I've ever had of my radio program. We had to look long and hard to find Cheryl because public radio over the years has not done a good enough job of giving people of color an opportunity to be engaged in the world of public radio and public television. In 2002, when I started on NPR, you'll find this hard to believe, I was the first person in the history of NPR, first person of color to ever have his own radio show every day in the history of NPR, although all of our tax dollars go to support that institution. And when I started on PBS in 2004, I was the first person of color in the history of PBS to ever have his own nightly show. And on NPR and PBS, the first person, no matter what color he or she is, to have a show every day that emanated live from the West Coast. So in other words, for all these years, all of our friends in public TV and public radio have apparently believed that smart TV and smart radio are a wholly owned subsidiary of the Eastern Seaboard, until we got a chance to try to disabuse the nation of that particular notion. But I want you to take pride in the fact that the one person that we did find to produce this public radio program that was unique, that was iconic because it had not been done before and people didn't think it was going to work, but that producer came from amongst you. She came from the Bay Area. Her name was Cheryl Flowers. And I would not be where I am today on public TV or public radio because the radio show came before PBS. So Cheryl made all of this happen. We worked very hard together every day. And at 40, when she got breast cancer, I was scared out of my mind, to be frank with you. It came and it went, and we celebrated and rejoiced, and it came back with a vengeance. She happened to have the worst kind of breast cancer, which seems to hit black women more than anybody else, triple negative. She had triple negative breast cancer, and it took her out pretty swiftly the second time around. But she was courageous until the end. We literally had to make her go home. I had to shut her office down, take away her computer passcode. She was trying to work even in the hospital, even though she was home dying. She continued to work. That's just a quick bit about Cheryl. To your questions expressly, what I learned from that, so many lessons, just a couple right quick. Number one, and there's a whole chapter in the book about Cheryl, and I won't tell you that story, but one of the most important lessons I learned in life about my own character flaw came lovingly, as you know, from reading the book, from Cheryl. And there's a whole chapter in the book and a wonderful picture in the book, one of my favorite pictures of Cheryl and the two of us together in the book. Every chapter has a picture next to it that ties into the chapter and the lesson learned. So you'll read the book about the chapter about Cheryl and me and what I learned about my own personality. She told me there was a particular trait that I had in my own character that if I didn't fix, it would be the undoing of me. And she was right about that. And so this was something that I didn't even fix until I was well into my adulthood. But Cheryl challenged me to fix this character flaw, which I did. And I still work on it every day, but it was Cheryl that taught me that lesson. But what I learned from watching her deal with this is that life, you know, is fleeting. It's fleeting, and for every one of us, that day is going to come. We don't know when that day is going to come. My friend Quincy Jones puts it this way, live every day like it's your last, because one day it will be. Cheryl taught me about maximizing the moment. When you see someone die at the age of 42 with so much life in front of them, for those who've had that experience, you know exactly what I'm talking about. It just takes something out of you. It took me about a year and a half to get myself together after that, just to kind of keep moving. But cancer is deadly, and it's something that we have to use every resource we have available to us to find a way to defeat it. But Cheryl has made me, I think, stronger and better person in death than I was during her lifetime.
Thank you for that. What do you foresee as being the most pressing issue for African Americans today and in the coming years?
It's hard to not put economics at the top of that list given the unemployment numbers, but I think that education and economics are inextricably linked. And so I would argue that Malcolm X was right, that education is our passport to the future. Tomorrow belongs to those, said Malcolm, who prepare for it today. I believe that without an education, people of color and women are twice defeated in life. For women, it's already tough given the patriarchy and the sexism. You got to have an education. For people of color, because of racism still being the most intractable issue in this country, it's tough as well. So education, I would always put at the top of my list, and I devote a lot of my time to talking about education. I have a really radical concept about how we fix education in this country. I'll drop this on you and leave it, and you can wrestle with it later on. We have a constitutional right in this country to many things. What we do not have is a constitution that guarantees every child in this country access to and equal high quality education. 50 different states that do it 50 different ways. If you're in Washington, you got a better education system because Boeing and Microsoft and Starbucks and Amazon and all these national companies are headquartered there, so you got more money being spent on education because of the tax base. If you're in Mississippi, where their number one export is catfish, you got to eat a whole lot of catfish in Mississippi and run your cholesterol up to raise enough money to get an equal high quality education as the folk in the state of Washington. 50 different states done 50 different ways. What would happen? How fundamentally could this country change if there were a constitutional amendment, which is the most difficult thing in the world to do, guaranteeing every child in this country access to, we're not talking about judging outcomes, we're talking about starting at the same place, access to an equal high quality education for every child in this country. It's worth thinking about.
You know, I think the specter of unemployment still looms very large. And your advice in the book is, I think, quite apropos. You say that getting the pink slip can sometimes be your stepping stone to success. Now, you outlined this collision that you had with Mr. Bob Johnson mm-hmm. at BET. I mm-hmm. think that's a story that really deserves to be retold. Can you tell us kind of summary
yeah.
how
short,
that came about?
The short answer is when I started BET, Black Entertainment Television, my first national show, I had a contract from the very beginning that allowed me, in addition to my work on BET, to produce, independently produce through my own production company, anything I wanted to produce. And for the first 4.5 years I was at BET, I produced a number of things that ran on other networks. So no big deal. In my last year at BET, Viacom bought Black Entertainment Television. And apparently none of the lawyers at Viacom read my contract, which said that I could independently produce anything I wanted for another network. And BET didn't even have first right of refusal. I didn't even have to show it to them even. I had to honor my job to be a talk show host on BET every night, but outside of being a talk show host on BET, I could independently produce anything else I wanted to produce. Long story short, I got a big exclusive with a woman named Sarah Jane Olson. You may recall the name. She was a member of the SLA back in the 60s and was accused of trying to kill some LAPD officers. And for 30-some years, she'd been on the lam, on the run for 30-some years. They pulled over for a routine traffic stop in Minneapolis, Minnesota, Minneapolis, St. Paul. She is pulled over one day for a routine traffic stop. They run her name, run her plates, and realize they have found a woman who has been on the FBI's most wanted list for 30-plus years. She's changed her name. She's gotten married. She has a family of 3 kids. Her husband's a doctor. She's very involved in the community, a wonderful community citizen in St. Paul, in Minneapolis, St. Paul. Wonderful person. Has changed her life all these years later, but never did do the time for the crime she was accused of having done. It was a huge story, front page of everything in this country, and everybody in the media was chasing this story, from Larry King to Dan Rather, who was still at CBS at the time, to Katie Couric and Matt Lauer, to Barbara Walters, Diane Sawyer. Everybody wanted Tom Brokaw. Everybody wanted this interview. It ended up falling in my lap. It fell in my lap because she had 2 daughters who, like a lot of white kids in America, were watching BET every night for all the music videos and all the shows. And so she had these two white daughters of hers were watching BET every night, and because my show came on right after the music videos, her kids started watching me every night. And they said, "Mom, when you go to trial in Los Angeles, where the trial was going to be held, the same place, the same building where OJ's trial was, when you go to LA for trial, when you start doing these interviews," apparently they'd been talking about the fact that she had to do some interviews to try to explain her side of the story. They said, "When you do some interviews, you should talk to this guy, Tavis. We watch him every night on BET. He's really very good." Long story short, I get a call one day, and everybody else is chasing the story. I'm not even following the story, really, John. I don't care about Sarah Jane Olson, whatever. I'm not even paying attention. I mean, I guess I'd read it past. I wasn't really following it, though. So anyway, I get a call, and I turn the interview down, because I'm like, Sarah Jane Olson, what? I don't know. And a friend of mine who was on her legal team called me and said, "You idiot. Do you know who this is? Do you know how everybody in the country is chasing this story and she wants to talk to you? This has fallen into your lap because her daughters told her to. And I figured out what it was, obviously. Did the interview, recorded it. And it was an interview that really didn't fit into my format on BET. So I wisely, I think, went to CBS. Viacom now owns BET. They also own CBS. I go to CBS, John, you understand these things, trying to keep it in the Viacom family. I first offered to CBS. They turned me down. Now, they turned me down because Dan Rather is chasing this interview. And I'm like, y'all don't understand. I already have the interview. I've already done it. Here's the tape. They looked at the tape, and indeed they saw. I gave them just a couple minutes so they could see I had, you know, I wouldn't give them my whole tape. I let them see a couple of minutes, and they saw that I indeed had it, but they still opted to try to go around me to get the interview from Sarah Jane Olson. And they reasoned that because I was in the BET Viacom family, that if they didn't put it on the air on CBS, I didn't have any outlet to air it. I may have been born at night, but it wasn't last night. I said, okay, I offered CBS this opportunity three times just to make sure I covered my behind. Three times I offered it, three times CBS said no. So I took my happy behind right down the street to ABC, and I sold it to ABC. And it aired in prime time on ABC as this big exclusive. It killed CBS in the ratings that night. So you know what happens the next day, right? The folk at Viacom called me and say, doesn't this Negro work for us? Didn't we buy BET? Isn't he on? Doesn't he work for us? Why was he on the competition last night killing us in the ratings? And of course, I end up, go figure, being fired. You know, for that. And that's why my career at BET ended, because I was the fall guy. And that happens sometimes. The whole point of this lesson, I talk about it in the book, it's not just that a pink slip can fire you up, because I said to myself when I got fired, this will never happen to me ever again. I am not going to go back on television until I own my own show. And however long it takes me to work that out, that's what it's going to be. I'm not going back on TV until I'm the boss. I said to myself, from this day forward, when I look in the mirror, I want all of my shareholders to love me. And sure enough, it took me 3 years to do the kind of deal I wanted before I got fired in 2001. I went to NPR for radio in 2002, but didn't go back to television until PBS in 2004. And sure enough, when I went back on TV, I owned it. So to this very day, I own my show on PBS. They distribute it. I own my public radio show. They distribute it. I own Smiley and West. They distribute. We own our own office building. Everything we do, we own. Not because I'm a control freak, although I think I know better than other folk how to use my own brand in the best possible ways. But ultimately, it taught me a lesson about entrepreneurship. And what I said today on KQED on the radio was not just that a pink slip will fire you up, but trust me on this. Sometimes what happens to you ain't got nothing to do with you. You get me on this? Sometimes what happens to you ain't got nothing to do with you. When you get downsized, when you get laid off, when the recession hits and you lose your house and everything, all hell breaks loose, that has nothing to do with you. Your karma isn't off. You're not out of alignment with God. Your chi is okay. You know, your talents are still intact. Your skills are still intact. This has nothing to do with you. The forces around you, the powers around you, you know, have nothing oftentimes to do with you. So when this happens to you, don't internalize it. Don't personalize it. Don't let it beat you down. Don't become depressed and despondent. Don't let that happen to you. These are conditions and circumstances oftentimes that you have no control over. All you can do in that moment is to figure out what your next step is. Get creative in that moment. Take a risk in that moment. Do something different in that moment. Try something you've always wanted to try. You ain't got nothing to lose at this point. Try something different, but don't internalize it. Don't beat yourself down over stuff you can't control. Instead, use that moment to get yourself ready. That's why I intimated earlier, if there were another word for failure, it's preparation. That's all failure is. It's preparation. It's preparing you for the next opportunity. So when you find your moment in these dead zones, in these quiet spaces, use that moment to get yourself ready. Get yourself ready in that moment so that you're ready when the opportunity comes to take advantage of it. But I learned a whole lot, as you can see, from being fired by BET and being fired so publicly, no less.
Thank you. Let's talk about The organization formerly known as National Public Radio, which has had over the years a conflicted relationship with African Americans. Mm-hmm. Specifically, I'm thinking of Brother Juan Williams and how he was let go. What are your thoughts on that?
The short answer on Juan Williams is I think that NPR could have let Juan go for any reason other than the one they chose. It was just such a bad, the timing of that decision and that, the hook on which they wanted to hang their hat. They just chose, quite frankly, the wrong incident, number one. Number two, knowing Juan as I do, and I say this respectfully, but I want to be honest and be truthful about this, respectfully, Juan Williams being positioned as the poster child for diversity and inclusion, given his commentaries on Fox News, is startling to me. It is funny to me that he ends up being the poster child for diversity and inclusion. That's funny to me. But what was even funnier than that to me was that Fox News would somehow wrap themselves in Juan Williams and a flag of diversity and inclusion when Juan is the only Negro on the air at the Fox News channel is hilarious to me. That somehow Fox News could take this moment and try to act as if they believe in diversity and they believe in inclusion and we're going to stand by and defend Juan Williams. We're going to beat NPR into the ground as if there's some bastion, you know, of diversity and inclusion when Juan is the only black man in the building. And then the points of view oftentimes he espouses don't even sync up with what's in the best interest of black folk. That sometimes the issues that he raises and the arguments he makes are antithetical to the best interest of black people. The fact that Fox News could just wrap themselves in all that was just mind-boggling to me. So quite frankly, I felt for NPR. I've been critical of NPR. As people know, when I left NPR after 3 years, I was the fastest growing show they ever had. My show was remarkably successful at NPR for the 3 years I was there. I left NPR and said so when I left because I didn't like the feeling, Professor Drummond, of being the spook who sat by the door. I didn't like this idea of being the only black man in the building. And so your whole diversity and inclusion is me. I mean, I am the diversity. I am the inclusion. We can't find other producers of color. You have no black folk on your board of directors. You have no black folk in leadership positions in the company. But every time that issue comes up, you put me out front. I don't like being used that way. I didn't like being manipulated that way. I'm all for diversity and inclusion if you're real about this. But don't use me as some token. I don't like being used as a token in that way. So I stepped away from NPR and I said, and I was asked by the media why I left. I told the truth. This is why I left. Well, fortunately, now there are a number of people of color at NPR because somebody got the message. They got a long way to go. But Michelle Norris is on All Things Considered. Michelle Martin has Tell Me More. And Michael Eric Dyson's on public radio. And Ed Gordon came through for a minute. Faracha Daya came through for a minute. So there are people of color now who have gotten some opportunities. I feel good about the ground that I broke being the first black person in the building. But as is often the case, he or she who breaks through the brush first gets the thorns.
You know, the political spectrum now is with Barack Obama as president has kind of obscured something, and that is, are there black politicians in the next wave? Mm-hmm. I mean, or is this going to be a one-time, every 100 years type of thing? Is there somebody out there that, or what are we doing to assure that there's going to be a smooth and even progression of African Americans into top political posts?
It's a powerful question. Let me give you two answers, Professor Drummond. The first answer is, this is why I push Barack Obama so hard. I said earlier, the great presidents aren't born, they're made. There is no Lincoln without Frederick Douglass pushing him. There is no FDR without A. Philip Randolph pushing him. There is no LBJ without MLK pushing him. He has to be pushed into his greatness or he will end up being another garden variety politician. With a divided Congress, he's going to start doing that Clinton triangulation. And what I thought was going to be a transformative moment in this country will end up being a moment more of symbolism than of substance. I say all that respectfully. That's why we progressives in the Bay Area and beyond have got to keep pushing him into his greatness on the issues that that matter most to us. And that's why I wanted to be successful, because to your point, I know that he's the first. I just don't want him to be the last. I don't want this to be every 100-year, every 400-year experiment in America. But he will be the first and the last for a long time if he fails. And that's why I want him to succeed, so that we can say we tried it and it worked. America didn't fall apart. As a matter of fact, the recession ended. People went back to work. We made some advances in the fight against terrorism. I want him to be successful, if for no other reason, that some other folk who look like him and some women into the future can be given an opportunity. I supported Obama. I don't campaign for people. I don't do endorsements. But in my heart, I believed that if Obama could be successful, it would open up progressive possibilities in this country. That's the reason why I was excited about the campaign. It would open up progressive possibilities. I don't want to foreclose on what I thought would be opened if he doesn't end up being successful. So we can't let him fail. We got to help him be successful. We got to help him fail up. And we do that by holding him accountable to the best of this country, and helping him to become not just a good president, but a great president. So I'm hoping that he will be successful if this experiment continues, number one. The last thing I wanted to just say, the second point of that very quickly, about those coming behind him, I hope there'll be others coming behind him, but I hope that they're very careful about what pages they take out of the Obama playbook. You can't take the Obama playbook and just play back everything he did in the way he did it, because there are some things that I'm not so happy with. So yes, let there be others coming behind him. Let's be careful of how we use that playbook.
Thank you very much. Our thanks to Tavis Smiley, noted television and radio broadcaster and author of the new book, Fail Up, 20 Lessons on Building Success from Failure. We also thank our audiences here on radio, television, and the internet. I'm William Drummond, and now this meeting of the Commonwealth Club of California, where you're in the know, is adjourned.